Good morning, everyone. We'll begin. A copy of the Open Meetings Act is located on the north wall of the legislative chambers. There is also an automatic external defibrillator, which is located on the back wall of the legislative chambers. Please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
This morning, I'm going to switch things up just a little bit. We're going to begin with the agenda for the Douglas County Board of Commissioners and go straight to some very important recognitions that we have. We'll recess out of that and then go back to the beginning of the agenda, starting with the Board of Equalization. So with that, we'll begin with the Douglas County Board of Commissioners. Roll call, please.
Commissioner Boyle, Commissioner Duda, Commissioner Kraft, Commissioner Morgan, Commissioner Rogers, Commissioner Tusha.
Here.
Madam Chair.
Here. We'll move to recognitions and proclamations. This morning we have some, again, very important people we are recognizing, and to help us get it started is our Human Resource Director, Mr. Lee Legere.
Good morning, County Board members. Lee Legere, Director of Human Resources, Civil Service. As a part of our County Government Awareness Month, we are beginning our Employee Service Award program as approved by the County Board back on March 18th of this year. Today, we're recognizing our county employees who have completed 40 or more years of service with the county. We have a total of 7 individuals to recognize, and their names are Jane Faust of the County Clerk's Comptroller's Office, Jim O'Donnell of the Health Center, Alfred Pacolot of the Engineer's Office, Dan Kulecht of the Engineer's Office, Michaela Knapp of the Health Center, Dan Silvis of the Assessor's Office, and Jerry Leahy of the Public Properties Department. On today's board agenda, there is a resolution on each individual to officially recognize their dedicated service to the citizens of Douglas County. At this point, the board should consider the resolutions honoring each of these individuals. So I think this would be the point to...
Do we have a motion to approve those resolutions? Please vote.
Madam Chair, can we remove one name if we want to?
Too late.
Now there are 7 people today.
April Fool's late.
Motion passes.
Okay. Go ahead.
Thank you, and I will now ask the following employees to please come forward with their elected official or department head when their name is called. And their family members, if they have any of them here, they're certainly welcome to come forward to receive the resolution thanking them for the years of service. Their elected official or department head may say a few words about them as an employee of the county. And we'll start with those completing 40 years during the 2014 year and then move up to our most senior employee. So our first person to be recognized is Dan Kulecht of the Engineer's Office with 43 years of service. So if Dan would come forward, and Tom Doyle.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning, Tom.
Dan Kudlick's been around since he's about 1971. He got out of the service after his Vietnam experience, and within 30 days he was an employee of the county. So he's been battle tested pretty well over the years. And Dan's an outstanding employee. You're familiar with him because he's made presentations before all of you many times before. Al Pacolat decided that he would not be here. He's a rather shy person, and when last seen, he was hiding under his desk. So, but Al is a great guy, and he sends his thanks and his appreciation for the recognition. But he said he'd rather stay at the helm of the ship of state while we're conducting these ceremonies. So with that, I'll pass it, as I usually do, with the bid deals to Dan Kudlick. Dan?
Thank you very much. I appreciate it. Well, I'll be brief. You know, why would somebody stick around for 43 years? Well, the answer is quite easy to come to. It's the people, you know, the people you work with. Starting with the top, you know, Tom Doyle, of course, and previous to Tom was Lou Lamberty, and George Earhart actually hired me. So I've been fortunate to be able to work with such great people, very professional people. All the employees that I've been associated with over the years is another major reason I've stuck around, of course. And you know, when you go back over time, four decades, you think of all the different people that have come and gone and what wonderful experiences I've had. And even with all the county commissioners, I must say over the years, have been very supportive, I would say, with the county engineer's office. It has made my job easier, and it's been a pleasure, and I appreciate the service award and being the first to accept this as an honor. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Dan, do you want to come around so we can shake your hand real quick?
Sure. Pleasure.
And Tom, you can come too if you want. Okay, good. Thanks for your service.
God, you're all loving all of them, aren't you?
Thanks for not hiding under your desk.
Our next individual is Michaela Knapp of the Health Center with 43 years of service, and Mary Powell is going to introduce her and say a few words.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning.
It's a pleasure to bring Mickey Knapp down with me today. She's been a dedicated employee at the Health Center for the last 43 years. She'll tell you a little bit of a story about when she started, and if they could do the job, they could come, and she's still doing the job, and we're glad to have her. I'm going to let Lori Davitt, who is her direct nurse manager, say a few words about Mickey also.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I've been fortunate to work with Mickey for the last 18 years. She's a ward clerk on my neighborhood. She's invaluable to us. She does an excellent job keeping everything straight up there. I don't know what I'd do without her. And she's just a very good person on top of that. And it's been a pleasure to work with her all these years, and I hope she sticks around a little longer.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. Well, I'm not much to be in the spotlight. I'm kind of a introvert, but I started at the Health Center. It was called Douglas County Hospital in 1971. I was a senior in high school. It was over Easter break. And four of my friends had heard about, Douglas County was hiring nurses' aides. I was working, as I recall, on the weekends at university doing laundry. And I thought, this is a better job. So went there. Back then, there was really no job application. I think I had to write my name down and my date of birth. That was it. They said, if you're interested, show up on Monday. The class starts.
Wow.
It was Easter vacation from high school. So I showed up, and my instructor was like an army nurse. And she didn't care if you knew how to give a bed bath or take a blood pressure. She just wanted to make sure you got the corners of those beds made right. So I did that. It was Monday through Friday, and Saturday, of course, it was an active hospital back then. It was, I was mortified because I had never, as a child, ever been in the hospital. I was a well kid, and so to see, you know, things like, you know, dead people, car accidents, because they put me in the float pool. So I went everywhere, and I'm like, I grew up about three blocks from county, and I'd walk home and I'd cry to my dad, can I please quit? Can I please quit? And he'd be like, just hang in there, just hang in there. So it grew on me. The training taught me nothing. It was like with some of the staff and the other nurses' aides that had been there for years kind of showed me what to do, kind of learned on my own. So I can't honestly remember when I started being a ward clerk. I remember that it was approached to me. There were several secretaries that were, you know, up there in years, and they had gotten ill, and they were really in a bind, and they asked me if I would do it temporarily. And I did it for like 6 months and then had to apply for the job. So I've been doing secretary work since then. And I've seen most of my life pass behind, you know, before me. Two marriages, grown three children, two grandchildren. I've had a really good life and I've been really blessed. And I'm soon, well, you know, I'll retire. I'm not sure when, you know, when I know it's right. But I enjoy my job and it's great. And it's a great place to work and great benefits. And I have met lots of wonderful people and made some good friendships. So thank you for this. I appreciate it.
Thank you for your service.
Yeah. Back around.
Our next individual to be recognized is Dan Silvis of the Assessor's Office with 46 years of service. And Mr. Morrissey would come forward with him and present the award to him.
County Board members, commissioners, I met Dan back when I was working in the city planning department a long time ago, back with Commissioner Boyle. And back then, I had hair and Dan didn't have any gray hair. And when I took office in 1999, the GIS section was the one section that had computers. And I found out real soon that, you know, not being a geek and not understanding the working of the computers, that I was probably going to need something real fast to learn what was going on with the computer site. I found it real easy when I see Dan taking the computer books home at night and the different mapping books home at night, and it was like, Dan, you know, I mean, you can do this. No, that's all right. I mean, just the enthusiasm and the love that he had for this and the thirst that he had for knowledge was, you know, anybody would be, any instructor, college professor, anybody would be real proud of that. And that's probably the word I have to say about Dan. I'm proud what he's done. I'm proud of the leadership he's provided. I'm proud of what he's trained and the leadership he's done with his staff. And I'm real proud when I get the emails and the calls that say, you know, I stopped by, I needed some information on legal description, I needed information on a map, I needed information on this, and boy, that section was really great, and that's a tribute to Dan Silvis. Thanks, Dan.
Thank you, Ron.
Thanks, buddy.
Thank you.
Well, thank you, Roger, and thank you to the commissioners and chairman. It's been a great ride. There's a song that says, don't blink. Yeah, it's true, because your life just goes poof. I never, when I started, thought I'd be here this long. I suppose no one did. Roger's right. The technology somewhat kept me here. There was always something to learn. And thanks to the commissioners for supporting that and funding a lot of our projects. I've worked with a lot of people. Some of them are your parents, uncles, cousins. So, I mean, yeah, Marianne, I and Mike, I remember him from way back. Well, yes, we both had dark hair. But it's been fun. I'm not going to take up a lot of time. I enjoy what I did all these years. I hope I have my staff trained in the knowledge that I learned, because a lot of it was done by the seat of your pants, so to speak. That's how you learn. And we did. And it's no longer someone calls in for information. We'll get back to you in 15, 20 minutes. It's push-button technology. And thanks to all of you. And that's all I have to say. Thank you for this.
Okay, our next county employee in the 40 years of service category has the most years of service of anyone in Douglas County. And that is Jerry Leahy of the Public Properties Department with 47 years of service as of last Thursday, April 3rd. And Patrick Bloomingdale is going to say a few words. And I believe Jerry's daughter and granddaughter are here.
Oh, isn't she cute?
So I've known Jerry for 21 years. When I came to Douglas County in 1993 as a wide-eyed law clerk, Jerry was already a county institution, which is saying quite a lot. I relied on Jerry a lot back then for advice and guidance. Yeah, you could say he was kind of like my Mr. Miyagi. Jerry is like one of those Sherpas who leads teams up Mount Everest, who can get to the peak practically with their eyes closed and certainly don't need an oxygen mask. Or perhaps more appropriate to our arena, Jerry can successfully navigate the many and varied political minefields without the need of a minesweeper to clear a path, relying just on his experience and his instincts to navigate safely. And for a long time, Jerry, I followed in your footsteps through those minefields and always assuring you that I got your back. Jerry is one of those few people left in the county who I can share old county stories with. But most of those stories certainly can't be shared in this venue. But perhaps over a cold one or three at Clancy's or Tigers. So, Jerry, congratulations on your 47 years of service. That just sounds weird.
Yes, it does.
And I look forward to working with you for the next 10 or more. Congratulations.
Thanks, Patrick.
Thank you very much. Commissioner Boyle earlier mentioned that. Something about April Fool's Day. Well, here's a little story about April Fool's, but the joke was on the county. As you all probably know, I got my start out at the county engineer's surveyor's office. At the time, I was hired by Bill Green. And I was allegedly a temporary. So I'm getting past that 60-day mark, and I'm thinking, what's going to go on after this? So I naturally lobbied for an extension. So about a month later, I got a call to go to the office, and I was offered a position to manage the county landfill, which was the first and only landfill in the state of Nebraska at that time. And it was designated to be under the county surveyor's office. So I accepted that. But they said that I'd have to work 6 days a week. And I said, well, I don't care about the 6 days. Am I going to get the money? And they said yes. But they said it would be also temporary. So I think I went about a year and a half with 6 days a week and then back off to five. But after that and throughout the progression, I became and was able to become engaged with the county's first CAO, Dick Schottker. And Dick included me in a lot of management-type meetings, and everything just went up from there. He had a lot of trust in me, and I felt that I put forth a good effort for him and the county. So I did all the landfill work for all those years, and then I guess I needed a challenge. And then the next CAO was Kathy Kelly, and indicated that I might be a good fit for the public property position. So That's how I got there. But as far as the total number of years and the number, it's a little embarrassing that somebody would stay for 47, but I have, and I guess I'd like to thank you all as commissioners for your support, and also say that the county's been good to me and my family. Daughter Tracy with me today, and granddaughter Holland. Two other daughters, one in Illinois, one in Kansas, unable to make it. But good for me, good for the family, and I think I've been good to the county. So hopefully you'll all be in agreement and I get a unanimous vote on the resolution. But thank you very much for the recognition. And my friend Lee Legere, there will be payback for this. Thank you. Thank you.
Well, I guess I'm going to get double paid back because we can't let Jerry get away here without a little special tribute. As everyone knows, Jerry means a lot to and a great deal to our county employees. I credit Jerry and thank you very much for hiring me 9 years ago, as well as a couple key individuals in the public property department such as Jeff McGill and Dave Peterson. And we'd like to say a few words about Jerry. But before we do that, I have noticed that there are names placed on buildings of individuals who have contributed a great deal to the community. For example, we have Epley Airfield. We have the Ron Roskins Room on the Farnham level of the Civic Center. And there's a Ed Zirinsky Federal Building and a number of buildings named after people and rooms, etc. So I think that the board should consider, at a future date, naming one of the county buildings in Jerry's honor. And to provide some ideas for this for future consideration, Jeff McGill, Dave Peterson of Public Properties have some potential locations to think about. So Jeff and Dave will present some pictures of what this could look like, and I'll ask the guys to turn on the overhead projector here. And we're going to talk about those.
That looks nice, Jerry.
Morning, Commissioners. Jeff McGill. It's hard to put words together about Jerry, but he's a go-to guy with abundant knowledge, and he's a person that really cares about county government. He's worked all these years, and he's a great boss. If you need to find out about history of facilities, call Jerry. If you need a contact for anything or anyone, call Jerry. And if you need a helping hand, call Jerry. I've been with the county almost 7 years now, and as a boss, he's very flexible, understanding. He's willing to move forward on new concepts, and thank God he's not a micromanager because I wouldn't get along with him. we put together a few things, some building considerations. Most recently, Jerry purchased the bus station, and we thought maybe it could be Jerry Leahy Bus Transportation Center. We're not sure what we're going to do with the building yet, but that's a possibility. The next one, Jerry's been involved with the Douglas County Correction Center. We can have the Leahy building right above the name of the building. And that'd be pretty fitting. We spent many years down there, and most recently yesterday with a few issues. The old Thomas Fitzgerald Veterans Home. I think 3 years ago we finished the CSI K-9 project in probably a quarter of the building. So it could be the Leahy building for future Douglas County offices. And last but not least, the future Leahy retirement and homestead. We're thinking about we could buy or maybe get the county to donate a small parcel and build him a house there. So when he does retire, he'll be close to where he started with the county. So with that, Jerry, thank you for being a great boss. We have a good time up in the office. We work hard, and everybody appreciates him. Thank you.
Well, with all these ideas out there, we do want to say how thankful we are to you, Jerry, and what a great job and great inspiration you are to the county. And Jerry, thanks for your 47 years and all that you do for everybody. And that wraps up our presentation this morning.
Thank you, Lee. And on behalf of the board, we congratulate all of you. And just, you know, this is a small token of our appreciation for what you do for not only within the walls of Douglas County, but for Douglas County as a whole in serving the public. And so we thank you for all your dedicated years.
Thank you. Thank you.
Jerry, we're gonna give this to you.
As an old math major, I always like to play with numbers, and I just have to point out, Douglas County is only 158 years old as a county. These employees, every one of them has been here for more than a fourth of the entire life of Douglas County, which the continuity and everything that they bring, I think, is just so important. It's neat. Over a fourth of the life of the county.
Pretty cool.
Let's get them committed.
Thank you, guys. Thanks for being here. Oh, thank you for being here.
Bye.
Bye. Oh. Okay, we will recess from the county board meeting. I need a motion to recess the county board of commissioners and enter into the agenda for the Douglas County Board of Equalization. Please vote. Please vote. And now roll call for the Board of Equalization.
Commissioner Boyle, Commissioner Duda, Commissioner Kraft, Commissioner Morgan, Commissioner Rogers, Commissioner Tusha, Madam Chair.
Here. Item A, approval of the minutes of the Board of Equalization meeting held Tuesday, April 1st, 2014. And item B, call for a meeting and set Tuesday, April 15th, 2014 as a date for hearing on certified assessment corrections reflecting the addition of omitted property to the tax rolls and increased value on property.
Second.
Any questions or comments? Please vote.
Motion passes.
Citizen comments. Is there anyone in the chamber wishing to speak to the Board of Equalization about an item not on the agenda? Seeing none, we'll move to item D. It's the denial of the 2014 real estate and personal property permissive exemption application for Woodman of the World Life Insurance and Woodman of the World Centennial Lodge 16. There has been a request that this be laid over until next week, and so I would ask for a motion to do so.
Second.
Any questions or comments? Please vote.
Motion passes.
Next is a approving application for tax exemption on motor vehicles recommended for approval by the county treasurer.
Motion approved.
Does that include adjournment?
Yes, please.
Second.
Any questions or comments? Please vote.
Commissioner Boyle?
I'm sorry, I thought I voted.
Motion passes.
We'll move to the agenda for the Douglas County Board of Corrections. Roll call, please.
Commissioner Boyle, here. Commissioner Duda, Commissioner Kraft, Commissioner Morgan, Commissioner Rogers, Commissioner Tusha.
Here.
Madam Chair.
Here. Item 1, approval of the minutes of the Board of Corrections meeting held Tuesday, March 11, 2014.
Motion approved.
Second.
Any questions or comments? Please vote.
Motion passes.
Citizen comments. Is there anyone wishing to speak to the Board of Corrections about an item not on the agenda? Seeing none, we'll ask the Director of Corrections to come forward for the report on corrections. Good morning, Dr. Foxtoff.
Good morning.
Morning.
Good morning, Commissioners. Mark Foxall, Director of Corrections, have before you the Board of Corrections report for March 2014. Closure number one, administrative services. We are 9 months into the fiscal year, not so new anymore. We still remain under budget. City of Omaha is billed through February 2014. They've paid 90% of the invoices through November 2013. And they have audited invoices through December 2013 and paid the balances through November 2013. It puts their balance at $617,738.72. Closure number two, an active month for community corrections in March. Several corrections personnel visited the 24/7 program in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. In March, to get a more detailed view of the program, his final preparations for launch continue. Also during March, initial staff who will operate the program were selected and trained on the software and the equipment. Some necessary coordination with the courts regarding some program policy questions resulted in a new target launch approximately mid-April, just kind of refining the forms, refining the policy, and refining the authorizations to participate in the program. We were very, very close on that. Nebraska Highway Office of Highway Safety Grant application for second year funding for the 24/7 program was also completed in March. Progress in converting to the new GED model has made some progress as well. A Pearson View, the GED testing company, finished their initial review of our contract. The contract is now being reviewed by the County Attorney's Office to assess questions and changes Pearson View included in their review. GED instructor vacancies will be filled in the coming weeks, and the updated teaching curriculum are being implemented in anticipation of becoming a GED testing site in the near future. So as you go around the country, everyone's having startup issues, but they're being resolved slowly as are ours, and we continue to make progress. So I will keep you informed as to that. In cooperation with Reentry Initiatives Council, Corrections and CMHC submitted a Second Chance Act grant application to establish an intensive outpatient treatment program for offenders with co-occurring mental health and substance abuse disorders. Word on the funding is anticipated in September. Also, according to the developer, corrections should begin testing with Collaborate, the web-based case management system, in April. It will be utilized by the Reentry Assistance Program, work release, and jail programs initially, with broader utilization in the future. A demonstration of Collaborate will be included in a presentation at the American Jail Association National Conference in late April. Work release. Clients donated 1,559 hours of community service in March. We had work release admitted 56 individuals during the month. House arrest, 95 admits during the month of March. 496 hours of community service were performed. Reentry Assistance Program admitted 23 individuals during the month of March. Corrections programs, that's in-house programs inside the main facility. Strategies to offer GED to inmates in protective custody or who are on lockdown, restrictive housing, are being implemented in order to increase educational opportunities for those folks. Just a point of clarity. This is something that typically haven't done by nature of the restrictive housing assignment, but as things change and people are in restrictive housing for longer for various reasons, We thought it best to try to provide some type of educational opportunities for these individuals, and that appears to be starting out well, starting out small, and then we'll expand it to the broader population. So I'm pretty excited about that. Pretrial services, 266 offenders were placed during the month, 793 individuals supervised with a 95% compliance rate. 26 offenders were referred for priority prosecution, saving 486 bed days last month. So for community corrections, it was very busy. With our compliance enclosure, ICE will be conducting their annual audit of us on the during the period 19 to 23 May of 2014, so we're preparing for that audit. Also, personnel, again, a busy month in March. We had two retirements, Lieutenant Brent Kraft, 24 years of service, most recently our training lieutenant, retired, Correctional Officer Glenn Mantle, 31 years of service, also retired. It's pretty exciting to you know, it's something you see a lot of, and it's probably good, so we're not a lot of experience going out the door, but these two individuals provided a lot to our organization. Glenn Mantle was assigned to work release and had been in work release for quite a long time, and was very, very versatile in the many different things that he could do while assigned to work release. So we're happy to see him go. We're sad to see the experience, but he's going to go on to life after, and as well as Lieutenant Kraft. So we're excited for the opportunities that await them in retirement. We had a number of promotions this month. A little ahead of myself. I do want to acknowledge newly promoted Sergeant Sean Bue for having become a certified jail officer through process American Jail Association. So very excited about that. Now, other activities under the personnel enclosure. These following individuals were awarded the President's Volunteer Service Award, and that's President of the United States Volunteer Service Award. Officer Cynthia Ramirez received a gold pin for her service. Sergeant Albert Bass received a gold pin for his service. Sergeant Stacy Chiak received a silver pin for his service. Officer James Starry, Officer Earl Hickman, Officer Danielle Matthews. So we're very proud to recognize these officers, these fine officers, and the work that they did, and having received the President's Volunteer Service Award. Moving on to other service award, in time with corrections, Sergeant John Gwinnett received his 25-year service award. So another long-standing employee with us, very versatile in his the task that he does. Promotions. Had several promotions from Correctional Officer 1 to Correctional Officer 2. Officer Brianna Chase, Officer Chris Grimm, Officer Christopher DeSangelis, Officer Heather Yostin, and Officer Stephanie Logan. Congratulations to them, who are now Correctional Officers 2. And one sergeant promotion, Correctional Officer 2 Sean Bue to sergeant. So he's recognized twice this month for his promotion and for, as I said, his certified jail officer designation by the American Jail Association. We also, during the month, awarded numerous commendations we're pretty excited about that. We had an award ceremony last Tuesday, and next May we're going to have another award ceremony. We've got another batch of awards coming through, commendations for commendatory awards for staff. So we're pretty excited about that as well. Talk a little bit about our population under Enclosure 6. 1,553 admissions last month. We had 1,558 releases. Our ADP, or average daily population, is 1,052. U.S. Marshal population is down a little bit. ICE population is up just a bit. Felony pretrial population increased. Misdemeanor pretrial population also increased. So it's getting warmer, better days, longer days with daylight savings time. So population is beginning to creep up. Female population decreased. However, third female housing unit still remains open. Closure number 7. Medical intake screenings, 1,007. Health and physical assessments, 434. Discharge referrals, 114. Initial psych assessments, 30. Initial mental health assessments, 105. Mental health infirmary placements, 44. Referrals to community-based mental health services, outpatient psych, 0. Mental health and co-occurring disorder treatment programs, 67. It's an important number, too. It's mental health and co-occurring disorder treatments. In other words, individual has mental health issues and they also have substance abuse issues that they're wrestling with. So this referral is very, very important if we're ever to try to stem the tide with respect to recidivism. Mental health therapy, 0. Long-term psych facility, 1. It was a very busy month at the facility, as evidenced by a lot of the different things we're doing, but we talk about mental health issues, we talk about substance abuse issues, but I think it's important to note in this report, the March report, that we had a very active period with community corrections, reentry types of efforts, reintegration, rehabilitation, adult basic ed, GED, alternatives to incarceration, and that's very important if we're ever going to sustain the types of things that we've talked about in the past. You just can't put something in place and then rest on your laurels and live with it for the next 20 years because you blink your eyes and you're behind the curve. So thanks to the community corrections staff, they just continue to be innovative in what they do, and we are seeing a changing demographic coming into the facility, and we have to change daily, weekly, innovate, always, if we are ever to stay ahead of the changing demographics that we see on the outside of the community that generate our 1,500 intakes a month, 17,000, 18,000 a year. And I don't know if I talk about that, but that's a lot of folks coming in the door, talking about 18,000 bookings annually. That's a lot of movement, and it's very busy down there.
You have a couple of comments, Mr. Boyle?
Well, first, I want to tell you that I did have a question. I had to think pretty hard, but I wanted to beat Pam Tusha to be the first to ask you. on the 24/7 operation, is that being what funds are involved? I heard you talk a little bit about that, but is that turning into kind of an expensive program or?
It's grant funded right now.
Grant funds.
Yeah,
okay.
Grant funds.
And it's in the $100,000 range?
Total?
Roughly.
Not yet.
Okay. That's fine. I just wanted to get that clarified.
And remember, you know, that our conceptually, we want to see that program sustain itself.
Yes.
With the fees that are coming in the door. And that's the goal.
Right. I agree. But I think even if there's some expense on the part of the county, that it's we ought to be talking about it, because I think even that would be reasonable, because I have real high hopes for this program, and from what I've heard about it, sounds really effective, does really good things.
There's a lot of partners involved, and,
right.
And all of the partners involved are all excited to see this thing go, and even though we haven't launched, other people are coming up to Mike and saying, hey, you know, we want to participate too, and say, well, wait,
yep.
let's get the pilot going first.
Yep.
So there's a lot of excitement across the criminal justice community about this launch.
Yeah, and again, thank to you and all of the others who brought that program to us. It really is a very unusual and apparently effective program. I wanted to ask you something kind of simple about the award ceremonies. A lot of us would be very interested in attending those ceremonies too. I think this morning is a really good example to take the time to acknowledge that we respect employees and the contribution they make. They are the ones, employees are the ones who are running the place. They're working and producing and under good leadership. So I think it's, Commissioner Borgerson, thanks for doing that. But I'd also like to get some notices of when these ceremonies are. Please don't have them at 6 o'clock in the morning, but anyway.
Yeah, we discussed that last week, and they've been lined up on Tuesdays because of
yeah.
a briefing that we have on Tuesdays. I'm going to move the date because it doesn't provide the commissioners the opportunity to come. So we're either going to move it to, you know, Wednesday or Thursday or some, trying to find a better day of the week, not a Tuesday, obviously, to launch the, to have the award ceremony so that admin and commissioners can attend.
It sounds like a small detail, but I think it it allows us to show our respect for the employees, and I think that's important. The last thing is really crazily simple. I wanted to ask you if, when you do these, whoever does these reports, if they could number the pages in a way that, for example, in section 2, if you could have 2-1 and then 2-2, because I'm able to follow you usually, but once in a while I get lost. But it's, if you could do that, I'd appreciate it.
We can do that.
Finally, I wanted to ask, what is the kind of a broad question, and if you can't answer it, it's okay, come back and do it another time, but what is the city's involvement in our correctional facility? Do they have police officers there? Do they have, I know we do cruisers coming inside the area to unload and load prisoners and so forth. What's the city's involvement in the Douglas County Correctional Facility?
Just drop off.
Okay.
And sometimes they'll pick up people to take out for interviews, but not much.
Who's doing the booking?
We are.
Douglas County employees.
Yes. Now, the arresting officer stays with the arrestee.
Okay.
And they do that initial, they speak through the window over in pre-book
right.
area and provide the initial information so that our booking officers can take the information and properly book the individual. But once that process is completed, those officers leave and go back in service.
Do you have a ballpark of what percentage of the residents are city residents? In other words, in your 1,000-plus population, what do you think?
No, we know what the city bookings are.
Right.
But I don't know what the city residents as opposed to county residents.
Right, or other residents.
Don't know that.
Okay, well, I would guess it's close to 50% anyway. But my thinking here is to the people on the building commission that maybe we can figure out some way to have the city participate financially in the operations of the correctional facility. Maybe. I don't know how we could, but...
Well,
do they?
Well, when the individuals that are booked on city charges, the city's paying a per diem.
Of course.
And that's what I talk about here in enclosure number one every month. So they're paying the fee.
Is the building commission paying anything? Are they involved? Okay, well, I'll work on that. Okay, well, I appreciate your comments. And again, I appreciate Patrick Bloomingdale's early reports yesterday morning on the flooding problem and the updates. And they're very, very informative. And I appreciate the action that you took to get that taken care of. And thanks for doing that so well, too.
Well, just a piece on that. That was, for us, we have isolated flooding. Sometimes it's a little bit more than you'd like to see, but it does happen. But yesterday was a pretty significant event for us in terms of how much ground it covered on that first floor, and it hit some of our critical areas. As I told you, it hit lobby, hit admissions, hit non-secure side, and it was working its way towards the courtroom. So we responded quickly. The staff responded quickly, and they were able to get it under control. Public properties, engineers, they were on top of it immediately upon notification, and they were able to identify the source of the obstruction immediately. So we're very thankful to them and pleased that Darrell Neely and Patrick Bloomingdale came down for an assessment. Jeff McGill from Public Properties came down. So again, it takes me back to an incident we had a couple of years ago when we make the call and say, hey, you know, we've got some issues down here, and mm-hmm. we can call upon the other resources in the county to help us address the problem. And indeed, they responded and turned a potentially bad situation into a not so bad situation. But if it had come through yesterday, it would have gotten your attention. So, but I think we recovered well from that. Fortunately, this happened on a Monday. We didn't have morning court. Otherwise, we would have had to cancel court. We were able to run court and open up the lobby approximately 12:30. So it worked out well. And, you know, you talk about incidents of that magnitude that ultimately become not so significant issues, and that's just not by chance or luck or something like that, but that's the staff. That's the staff that jump on it, and it was a tough. You were there. It was a tough job to do, and the staff got on that, and they turned a potentially significant issue into a not so bad issue, as I've said before. As we're talking with the county court bench on, okay, if we have to cancel court, we have to talk to Wayne, Captain Hudson, about, okay, now we've got to transport weekenders, Friday, Saturday, Sunday bookings over to the Hall of Justice for court. That's a huge transportation nightmare. County court bench has to make some adjustments, prosecutors, public defenders, private attorneys, and that didn't happen because we opened up on time. And again, that's the staff. That's the staff working really hard, not waiting around for some private company to come through. That staff working hard to get it done. And I take my hat off to them, because I tell you what, you see that old reality TV show, Dirty Jobs, that was a dirty job. So my hat's off to the staff. I couldn't ask for better staff.
Well, congratulations for doing so well.
Thank you.
Commissioner Tusha?
Okay, he's had some well-rested weeks, so he got to it before than I did. Hey, again, I agree with you, with your staff. Please let them know thank you for over and above their normal job duty to take care of situations like this, so please forward that on to them. Second of all, and I know last Tuesday you did have the recognition program of the awards and certifications, but several of us had early morning meetings even before the board meeting. So, yeah, I would like to attend these, and I know it's kind of tough for you to move these meetings, but I appreciate it. I think several of us would be able to attend these once you move them. So, thanks for that. But also, this is awesome with the promotions and commendation and awards. This is totally awesome. So, again, congrats to everybody on that. I really appreciate that. Okay, to my notes, as I shared with you all my yellow posties this morning. We didn't have a chance to trade books, by the way.
It's not too late, Commissioner.
Yeah, I know. You wish, don't you? I just want, there's some good news in all of this, honestly. I just want to say, with the overtime and the vacation and sick and workman's comp and absences, all that's gone down. So great, great job. That was really nice to see. I understand that it fluctuates, but it was really nice to see everything just drop. So thank you for your employees and your staff to work on to keep that down. I really appreciate it. On that sobriety, and I know Mike is here, but I just got a quick question. You had made a comment in here that you had to postpone this because of some program policy questions. Is that going to cause extra funding, or is this just...
No, it's just verbiage, language,
okay.
Making sure that what we talked about in the work group meetings is consistent with the policy that we're promulgating. So it's nothing that's going to add additional cost to the program.
Okay. I just wanted to double check on that. Also, on that note, that I appreciate you offering the GED to inmates in lockdown. I think that's awesome. You know, everybody should have a chance for this. But if they're usually in lockdown for most of the day, are they going to have computer access in their cells, or are you going to escort them?
Escort them to where the equipment is, where the tester is, where the instructor is.
Okay, isn't that going to be a little bit difficult because you can't mix some of them, am I correct? Are you going to do one at a time, or?
One of the first things we did was to find out when we had downtime, non-class time in our programs area or some of our interview rooms, and then we're going to coordinate that instruction time with those time. In other words, what I didn't want to do was to vacate a whole class of individuals so we could bring one person in. That'd be effective, not efficient. So we worked with the GED instructor, Mike, Justine, Wall, and we found some times where we can work with the lockdowns. The most important thing up front is get them tested, find out where they're at, so then we know what type of curriculum to direct towards them.
Well, I appreciate you doing that. I think that's awesome that you guys are able to do that. And I know they, in the long run, will also appreciate it. So thank
you
for
doing
that.
And once we get them started, you know, we can send their paperwork and books and other materials to their housing units, so they can study when they're in their room.
Oh, keep the boredom intact a little bit there.
Yes.
One other quick question. You said the female unit remained open for March. Is it still open this month, too?
Yes, it's okay. Due to the number of keep separates that we have.
Yeah, and I understand the situation because I know we've discussed that before. So right. I didn't see the month of April on there. So I just wanted to double check on that. We have talked about your inmate population with the mental side of the population is increasingly getting worse. Now, do you need to, I know you talked about training for your staff and stuff and the correctional officers. Do we need to consider extra additional help to be able to, because it's shifting, you know, mm-hmm. It's going from one to the other. Do we need to kind of consider that in the future, or is that something you'll still be able to handle on that?
No, I'm working that. You know, you don't have our 14-15 budget yet, but I'm working those numbers into the budget, recognizing the past year that we've had with regard to intake of individuals who have mental health issues. So we're working that into the upcoming budget, but it's just not a matter of throwing people at an issue. But I am going to request more people, but it's also a matter of bringing in more training as well. And I've contacted the National Institute of Corrections, Department of Justice, as we've discussed, and mm-hmm. They're going to help us host a CIT training on site. And working with, talking to the DOC, Department of Corrections for the state, I'm talking to the University of Nebraska at Omaha. And what I'd like to have is a train-the-trainer. I think there's some opportunities for a well-respected CIT training program up in Denver. I think we're going to try to bring them down here. The CIT training is modified for corrections. So I think it's something that we can host here in Omaha and bring other facilities in jails and prisons from around the region so they can participate too. Talk to NIC, as I said, spoke with Mike Jackson. He's excited about the opportunity. He knows who to speak to. Good. At DOJ, and he knows where we can get the technical assistance from out of Denver. So I'm pretty excited about that. That's huge. All of the folks that sent to CIT training locally have spoke highly of it. So I'd like to try to run all my staff through, get my people trained up so they can do it. We can add it to the in-service training, and I'm really looking forward to that. Right now it's two or three seats a year, and that's certainly not enough. So we're going to expand the reach of CIT to all of my staff.
So you're going to do it with all your staff?
We're going to, once our staff are trained in how to put on a CIT training and certify our people, we're going to do it.
Okay, well, that's great news to hear that. I know some of the correctional officers are concerned about this, and they have every right to be, because like I said, your shift change is really going the opposite way. As far as your employment with your staff, I noticed you're a little bit better than you were last month. And I believe you just had a graduating class?
Yes, we had a class start on the 24th of March. And those individuals, 11 of them, are now up in the shadow. They're in week three. They're in the shadow for week three. They will graduate week six, so a couple more weeks for them, 2.5 more weeks for them, and they graduate, and then they go into the FTO program for 3 weeks. And then we've posted again. We've got another class.
That was my next one.
We've got another applicant pool that we're getting ready. So as we move into, as I said, we're attriting approximately 2.5 a month. So we're posted. And in anticipation of that attrition, we'll be ready so we don't get behind in the hiring process. And I will say that our staff have been very actively recruiting in the community. I think we had 300 plus applications, something like that. So that's pretty good. And we've been hitting a lot of area colleges and universities, and other venues to recruit. I've seen our flyers at different places that I've been, so that's a good thing. And, you know, it's a good job. And as some of the 40
it's hard, but
some
it's
of the 40-year folks have said, you know, that it's a good job. It pays well. The benefits are good. It's a tough job, but people that self-select into this position aren't looking for a cakewalk. They know it's going to be difficult. So I'm really excited about the prospect of the applicants who we're going to get
good
with this most recent recruiting effort.
Good. When you set out for, like you said, postings all over, do you send it out to anybody, or do you target specific? Is there schools that kind of train these people to go into this type of field? Do you target that, or do you target just anybody?
Well, we sit down with the people that are going to go out. We sit down as an executive staff. We make a decision as to what career fairs, for example, we're going to attend, what colleges and universities that have criminal justice programs that we're going to attend. That dictates where those flyers are going to go. So rather than have a flyer, recruiting flyers at a student center someplace, it's going to put it right in that criminal justice department's office,
okay,
or that sociology department's office. So people that are inclined to get
mind
into that position,
yeah,
anyway, are going to see our flyer right there.
Awesome. And one other comment, I was talking to a constituent this weekend, and he also asked me about the jail population and about the inmates and the mental stuff, and he said, wouldn't it be nice, and it really took me by surprise to a certain extent, but then on the other hand, it didn't, because he said, wouldn't it be nice if we had courses in there so people in there and the inmates can go to anger management or AA or something like that, and wouldn't it be nice if they had their GED? And I said, we have that. And he had no idea on that. So I gave him a little bit of lesson on your behalf, saying that we are doing that to the support we can to help these, you know, for when they do leave the inmate population. And he was really pleased to hear that. So
well, two things I think can help that. One is the government awareness month, and trying to get that word out, or have people come by and take a tour of the facility and say, you know, we're not just a lockup.
Exactly.
We are not that. And it amazes me, not anymore, but people that come through on tours, students that come through, criminal justice classes that come through, oh my gosh, you know, what were you expecting? But, you know, their perception is shaped by what they see on television, and we're not that kind of facility, you know. And you know, again, it's back to the staff, it's back to the leadership, and we don't want to be some stereotypical challenging facility that you see on one of those reality television shows. It's not what we're trying to be. So when people come in, I guess it's a good thing. Yeah, I want you to be shocked. You say, wow, I didn't expect it to be this quiet, I didn't expect it to be this sanitary. Yesterday,
well, that's
an exception,
the old school,
but,
and that's what they think.
Right. So I'm glad that people come through, but obviously we've got more work to do. We need to get more people to come through and take a look at what we do, not just the physical plant itself, but what we're actually doing with the people that come through our door, come through our back door, with those 18,000 bookings that we do a year. We're not just a holding facility. You know, we're trying to do something else with those individuals as they come
through.
Well,
I got across to one yesterday, and word of mouth is very powerful, so hopefully he can share that. But, yeah, I did share that with him.
And I mentioned something to you a few months ago, and we've got the groundwork laid for Citizens Academy, much like what law enforcement offers. And that's to come through, and we haven't got the time frame down, but you come through, and you kind of follow along like a new hire, and you learn what they do, or what they're trained, or what they see, or what they're exposed to, or what the inmates are exposed to. So I'm trying to get that off the ground.
Oh, that'd be cool. And, you know, I think some of us commissioners, Mike, should go to that. Now, that'd be kind of neat to be able to, you know, see that. Because, you know, we go for tours and we see what you guys do, we hear what you guys do. But again, like I said, as you and I talked earlier, experiencing it is something just totally, totally different, as I previously went through. But I just wanted to share with you that I did pass the word along that,
you know,
it's not the old school anymore. We do try to give them training and education classes to help them further themselves.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Commissioner Kraft? One quick question. You know how I feel about acronyms. CIT, for those in the listening audience, if you'd explain that.
Certainly, Crisis Intervention Team.
Thank you.
And these individuals are trained. It's a 40-hour training, 5 days, where they're exposed to a lot of ways to respond to individuals who are mentally ill, teach them different techniques, teach them basically verbal techniques, what to expect, what are the expectations. People that have mental health issues aren't all, you can't put those individuals into one category. There's across the spectrum different ways you deal with folks who have different types of afflictions. So the crisis intervention team tells you in a crisis situation how to improve your interpersonal communication skills with those individuals, what to say, what not to say, things of that nature. It take a lot to get into, but it's heavily scenario based too, which is really important. How do you respond in this situation? How do you respond in that situation? They bring in actors that participate in the scenario, so it's about as real as you can get without being involved in the situation. So what we're going to replicate here for corrections is just like the Memphis model from which it's adopted. It's going to be heavily scenario based. We'll have all the professionals in that we need to bring in, and expecting great things from it. Talking to other folks around the country, not just locally, everybody has had positive things to say about it and how it's helped their staff deal with mentally ill individuals on the street and inside a correctional facility, whether it's a jail facility, a detention unit, or a prison facility.
Thank you. Then the population, Commissioner Tusha said, is shifting. Is it really shifting toward more mentally ill, or is we just responding more to those who are mentally ill?
Both.
Okay. Thank you.
Commissioner Tusha?
Mark, one other quick question. In your report earlier, you talked about inmates who are not only coming in because of their mental disability, but they're also, you're finding additional, whether addictions or whatever. Is that also steadily increasing?
Yes.
And
I think so.
Now, will the CIT training, I'm assuming that they'll hit on this also?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Mark, what's the number of hours that we utilize the peer support specialists over there?
Ooh, that's a CMHC, Cindy Boganowski question. Unless, Mike, do you know? I'm not sure.
Well, here's my point, is that it's budget time. You don't have to.
Okay.
My point is that it's budget time. And one of the things that, as you're looking, Mark, at what we should be including or adding to the area for that would be a peer specialist, full-time in that area. I think that would be a really, really good and important addition to work with staff.
We've talked about that. We're looking hard at that. Okay. And that's an area, certainly, that we're looking at.
Yes. Commissioner Boyle has a question or comment. Commissioner Boyle?
Yes, I wanted to follow up on something. I wasn't going to bring it up yet in public, but we had a meeting with Sherry Glassap about using some facilities at 42nd Street. What's the progress for mentally ill inmates? What's the progress on that?
We had a meeting a couple of weeks ago with the region, and we're trying to find a resource, an expert, if you will, to help give us some information on how to proceed with a unit like that. What are the ups? What are the pros? What are the cons? I'd like to have something. This summit that I keep talking about, the focus has changed as issues have changed over time. And one of the things we're going to focus on is try to bring somebody in that can talk about this forensic mental health unit. And when I was at a national conference a couple of weeks ago, brought it up as a hot topic, if you will, and some places had it. Los Angeles was building one. Some people I don't think a lot of the comments were off the cuff. I don't think some of it was well researched, and hopefully our partnership with Region 6 and CMHC, we can get down to some more tangible evidence as to, does it work? Where would it work? How's it going to look? Who's going to pay for it? What type of people would be going in? How are we going to staff it? There's a lot of different issues to talk about. But I think with this national expert that we're talking about bringing in to Omaha, and Joe Kinney knows who that is, that's some of the piece that we're going to get at. And I told Joe, we'd like to, and Patty, that we'd like to get to that sooner than later, because the exigency of the circumstances call for trying to have that meeting soon, and then providing that information to decision makers about how to move forward. It's complicated.
And I appreciate it is. I just, I'll say this, anything that I can do to help you get that accelerated or get those things achieved, I'd be glad to, because I think it could work. It works other places, but we just have to set it up correctly.
Sure.
So I agree with you, and I'm glad you're doing it in a very methodical way, but, it'd be nice if it was a little more accelerated, methodical. But I know what you mean. Do
well,
what you have to do.
When I go to the end of the month, I'll be attending the American Jail Association's national conference, and I've been assigned a four-hour block of instruction down there, and yep. One of the topics is going to be that. So I'm researching that myself for the presentation, so I'll have more knowledge on that. Plus the interaction that we get from the audience down there. Denise is going, Mike's going to be there, so we're going to mine the resources down there to find out what this forensic mental health unit is going to look like.
Okay.
So hopefully bring back more information, and perhaps we should talk about our criminal justice committee meeting so we can debrief.
Thank you very much.
I think that we needed to wrap back around though with the state and whether with the IMD issue as to whether or not those beds can be increased again for use with mental health issues because of that whole Medicaid reimbursement issue. So maybe we need to follow up. Sherry was going to ask, and I know that they had a little bit of a delay because of some major health issues with the Medicaid director down at the state. That was kind of backlogging everything, but we probably need to figure that out first because there's no use going to figure out what it would look like if we're told we can't do it because of that. So,
I raised that issue with some people at the conference, and I got blank looks on the faces down there. So that tells you it's not something that at the jail level anyway that's been widely implemented. So, and you're right, if we can't figure out that piece, then we can't get out of the starting block.
Commissioner Borgeson, is there any possibility that we could begin talks with the facility, Lasting Hope, up on 24th Street and ask them if, they could become a partner in serving this particular group of people?
Well, there's actually discussions. We were just at, Denise was at the meeting, Mike was there, the region was, there was this humongous group, and what the Magellan, who manages the state's Medicaid program, wanted to talk to us in the community about a psychiatric emergency service, which means we would set up an emergency room where every single person with mental health issues would go there for assessment. Now, if you remember when Lasting Hope was put out there, that was what it was supposed to be, was
right.
Entry way into the services. Well, that's not panning out. Nor did it have, when it started, the medical component. So if a police officer had someone in the back of their cruiser and they were bleeding from a deep cut, they could not go there. They'd have to go to an ER, take care of the suture, and then go back to Lasting Hope. Well, that wasn't working either. So the thought process is, let's talk in the community about whether or not we want a psych emergency room, and it could be a freestanding, which would be very, very expensive, or it could be attached to a hospital. Now, many years ago, we approached Bergen when we opened up the Spring Center many years ago, which was a voluntary crisis center where people who voluntarily just needed some help could walk in. But we said, you know what, we should be, there should be an agreement or an attachment to those who aren't voluntarily coming in, and maybe Bergen would be that because they're the closest. Bergen wasn't interested at that time. So now we've come full circle in this world, and we're talking about that very thing again. And so we had one meeting. There's a smaller planning group that was put together to continue the discussions of it. Sherry Glassnap offered at that meeting that maybe instead of opening up a full-fledged ER, maybe we should be spending the dollars more wisely in placing mental health professionals in each ER so that they then would become the, you know, a designated area within each emergency room. So they're going to be looking at those ideas. Magellan is kind of spearheading the process. And so as soon as we hear back, I mean, this just occurred, what, a couple weeks ago, 2 weeks ago? So once that smaller planning group meets and has any more details, we'll bring it back. But it's, there's, that's, they're at the table, actually. But they would not be at this point unless the medical component was incorporated into that facility. It wouldn't work. So there you have it.
Very disappointing.
Yeah. So we'll keep working and trying to figure out what there should be. But I do like the idea of, I mean, because you think about the law enforcement person who is coming from all points and they're driving by ERs, that's not good for them either. But if you had that point designation or within each ER that could take care of those individuals, that may be the better of the two answers. So
I guess one last question. Is there anybody in charge of this, or is it just all a whole bunch of people that are trying to get it straightened out? And you know, to me it looks like there's nobody in charge.
No, there's constantly. Region 6 is the behavioral health planning authority of the region.
Okay, so they're in charge of it.
And they constantly work with providers to see what the gaps are, the issues are, meet with providers on a monthly meeting. We come up with the plan on what we should move forward with.
But can they force any changes?
Well, they can't force unless the state, the state has, even though we're designated as the authority, the state can trump in different spots, which has happened over the course of time. But we now, I think, have within our region a very well oiled working machine of cooperation. We have the key people from the state there, but that doesn't necessarily mean that it ends there. But yes, there's definitely people in charge around the table that are trying to figure all these things out.
Well, I guess what I'm looking for is somebody that can say, do this and do that without, I mean, all this other,
I like
collaboration.
You don't have money.
No, but I'm just saying that's why this thing is floundering. We have no one in charge of it.
I don't agree with that. I mean, you have all kinds of people that want to do what needs to be done, but if it's not going to be paid for, none of the providers are going to want to do it.
Well, and that's why we need to have somebody in charge who gets the thing put together and has the authority to not, whoever it is, including the governor, in the side of the head and say, you know, we need $89 million or whatever. We need somebody in charge. That's one of the big failures, I think, and I hate it to say this, but county government, you know, just really, to me, I'm sorry, but there's nobody, one person in charge. And
I think
there needs
person.
To be, in some of these areas, particularly mental health, there needs to be somebody who's running the show. And I know there's a lot of good people who care about it and have a lot of experts, a lot of knowledge and everything else, but it doesn't do a lot of good if there's no one who will stand up for it and really make it work. I mean, you know, you need a powerful figure to take it and make it work. That's my estimation. So, I don't know.
We talked about that in our planning meetings for the summit, and trying to identify who could that powerful neutral convener be that could host this thing. And I'm not sure who that is. We're working on that.
We're working on it.
But you know what? You have to stay positive.
Yep.
It's a huge problem. And I think the fact that the conversation, because this isn't new, this isn't a new thing, but the fact that the conversation has been elevated to this level is a win-win for us, because now we're not the only ones wringing our hands and talking about it. We're talking about it at this level, and it can only go up from there. So the more we continue to meet and continue to have ideas, continue to kick around potential alternatives to the status quo, then it's got to work its way to different bodies that can make decisions with respect to, okay, how do we pay for this, how do we, so on and so forth. So you're never pleased with the status quo, but we're going in the right direction, and that's positive, but we have to keep our foot on the gas.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yep.
Thank you.
With
Thank
that,
you.
We will and go back into the Douglas County Board of Commissioners meeting.
Yes.
Okay.
Second.
Please vote.
Motion passes.
First item is minutes and claims. Approval of the minutes of the Board of Commissioners meeting held Tuesday, April 1st, 2014. And item B, approval of claims submitted for payment process through Tuesday, April 8th, 2014.
Motion approved.
Second.
Any questions or comments? Please vote.
Motion passes.
Next is the consent agenda, items A through H, for a total of 8 items.
Motion approved.
Second.
Questions or comments? Commissioner Kraft.
We are always being asked by people, how can we consolidate? How can we do more regionalization? And there are 2 items on this that are movements toward that, item B and item C. Item B is the interlocal agreement between Douglas County and the City of Valley for electrical inspections. Now, it's small, but it's still a step. Item C is a resolution approving an interlocal agreement between the City of Omaha, Sarpy County, Washington County, and Douglas County to establish a local workforce investment area system. Now, this is a little bit bigger, but we are constantly looking for ways that we can streamline and save dollars to our constituents. Thank you.
Please vote.
Motion passes.
Citizen comments. Is there anyone in the chamber wishing to speak to the Board of Commissioners about an item not on the agenda? Hi, Laura.
Hi, I'll be brief, I promise.
Good morning.
Hi, Laura McCormick, 7414 Valley. I'm not going to speak in acronyms today. I'm talking about Juvenile Detention Alternatives Initiative, JDAI. I'm hoping that you can explain to me what the procedure for appointing members of the public to the JDAI collaborative is. Let me just provide some brief detail. JDAI, the collaborative, was formed in 2011. The current working plan, which was approved just last week, stipulates it's going to take until December 31st, 2014 to even define who in the community will participate and how they will participate on the collaborative. I recently attended a family team meeting for a youth who was detained unnecessarily. I was the only person among the 18 to 20 state and county employees in attendance, and by the way, I don't work for the county, to point out that this child was unnecessarily detained as a result of an override of the probation risk assessment tool. The override rate for low-risk offenders is 60%. The national override rate is 15%. I believe members of the public need to be appointed immediately, and that the collaborative and subcommittee meetings should either be audio or videotaped. I have spoken with the comptroller's office. They assure me that the technology does exist to provide a record of these meetings. How can this be accomplished?
Thank you, Laura.
Thank you.
Anyone else wishing to speak in front of the board about an item not on the agenda? We do have a presentation. The presentation is to discuss the problem in our city with poor and homeless women and children. James, do you want to come forward?
Yes.
Good to see you again.
Morning.
Good morning, commissioners. I'm here today because I'm doing a protest. It started actually Thanksgiving. I have a young girls youth program, and they decided that somewhere they read in some religious thing that to protest against the treatment of Jesus, they grew their hair long and grew a beard. So this is my fashion statement right now. I can't shave until after Good Friday. So, and it's dry, I'm sweating because it's hot and all this. But what I'm here for today, I want to start a communication or a discussion throughout the whole state. And the reason I'm at the Douglas County is probably has the largest population of homeless women and children. And we need to deal with these women and children because last year I was here and I told you the summer was very bad about people dropping off women and children. The winter has stopped. We have a long winter this year and it's really has put a little damper on it. But it's already started. I just helped a Hispanic lady who her husband got deported, and she was left with two children and owing rent. Well, there's this bad group out there in South Omaha, well, throughout the city, called the cartel. And the cartel is taking these ladies and paying their rents and their lights and selling them on the street. Our Lady of Guadalupe and myself prevented it. One of the ways we did, we paid her bills and helped her out and actually got her a job. I also did something not the normal way. I got into confrontation with the cartel. They threatened me and all this, and I'm the kind of guy, you know, when, this beard shows me when I was younger, I was more of a violent person then. So I actually took care of that. But the problem out there, and it's going to be starting, women and children get dropped off here in Omaha because we have the reputation of being good for people. Remember a few years back when they were dropping babies off? It's still happening, but now the women and children are being dropped here. And I estimate probably 50-some mothers and children will not be able to go into a shelter because their shelters are full. So we need to talk about this, and I'm trying to buy three buildings over on 24th and Jones and develop them into apartment houses for women and children only. The problem is I got a 501c3 started, I got a bank that's involved, but I need a government agency to push this on. And everybody says, well, can we afford it? If we take volunteers and restore these three buildings, we will save hundreds of thousands of dollars in restoring these buildings. So that would be equity for the buildings. And so the banks would help us provide more money to do more things, to hire certification people like heating, air, and all this. But the problem is I don't have a planning person to do a business planning on this. And that's something Douglas County could help me with. And plus, you know, if I go out to get $1 million loan, they're not going to loan me no money because of the beard. No, for other reasons. But they would help work with us, with Douglas County, if they would help me take over this. And that's what I'm here. And just for the, we need to start talking about, instead of throwing women and children in shelters. I was in Germany here about 2 years ago. In Germany, they don't put their people, women and children, into shelters. They find them places to live. And this country is the most powerful country in the world and the most richest country in the world. Yet we have third world treatment of women and children in our country. So we need to change that, and I would love you to start a communication with public officials, the state of Nebraska, because every time we cut food stamps, you know, they cut a big $1 billion of food stamps. You know, we might be saving tax money, but we're hurting women and children. I hate to get into politics, this unemployment insurance. Right when they stopped that, I seen 20 to 30% more need on the street. So, you know, I understand that people hate paying taxes, but I believe people will pay taxes if we use the tax money right. And the best way to use money right is help the women and children. You know, we all gripe about bullies, gang members. Well, every gang member, I've worked many years with them, there's children that has had their lights cut off, their gas cut off, and they're getting kicked out of houses. If we can prevent that, you get rid of a lot of bullies, a lot of gang members, a lot of criminals, because poverty does commit crime. So that's what I wanted to say, and I hope you could get back with me so we could start communication on this problem.
I'll wait, Mr. Boyle.
Jim, thanks a lot for coming down. I always appreciate hearing from you. Some of the things you talked about have already been done. There's some people who are doing them, and I'm a real believer in not trying to duplicate what's there. But I'll mention to you a couple things, and I know that you are fully aware of them. One is Mike Sacklar has put together a housing program on the facility for people. Really what you're talking about, I believe, and he did it through the Douglas County Housing Authority, I think it was Douglas County, not City of Omaha. The other thing for permanent housing, there are two housing authorities in operating in Douglas County, Douglas County Housing Authority and the Omaha Housing Authority, and I'll be very candid, I mean, I know every year there are lines to get the vouchers and get in, but those are the two facilities that provide it, and I don't know if, there's temporary shelters which you don't want to go to. We set one up years ago for children and families, St. Vincent's, and that worked. I don't know if it's still operating or not. The another component that is of some help to the young people particularly is, youth emergency services. And so I think what I would do if I were in your shoes, rather than try to scrounge all these things together yourself, the $1 million and all that, and buy these places and renovate them and all that and get into the whole thing and codes and all that, I really would encourage you to talk to somebody like Mike Sacklar and say, you know, Mike, and I'd be glad to be there present with you to talk to Mike about what can be done to build some more facilities for the people you're talking about. And there's one other group that's really, really left out too, and that's the foster care children that have aged out. That is a first-class disaster, and it is really terrible what we do to young people who get out of that system. They just open the doors open and they're gone. So I feel there needs to be some kind of remedial housing for them, some place to go where they can call it their own and get on their feet. That's another component. So I couldn't agree with you more about the problem. And I hope we could work with the solution, but I'd be glad to personally help you with Sacklar and some of these others and get some ideas about what we could do.
See, one of the things you were saying about all these places that there's quite a few of them, but like the housing you're talking at Francis House, there's a year and a half waiting list for people, and they deal pretty much with medical problems. Okay, I've been involved in that. Open Door Mission. Open Door Mission is a very good organization. I can't say the name of the place there. They help a lot of women. But the thing is, that's temporary help. Then if you look at the housing authorities around here, they're year and 2 years waiting lists for these places. And then you talked about the foster care. Foster care has been not a joke, but very serious problems with foster care since I was working with the gangs. A lot of gang members I got in South Omaha came from the foster care, and the abuse that these people do because there's not enough screening. And this is my opinion on this foster care screening. And then we take mothers, their children are away from mothers and put them in foster care while they're doing this drug stuff and stuff like this. My opinion is take the children and the mother and put them in, and work with them. Once you separate that child from that mother, there's a separation of love. And they had a thing on Channel 7, the child crisis, talked about this woman. She don't even know her children no more because they've taken it away. And then if you ever work in the court system, it's very slow. And to work with children, you know, children are only young for so long. If a child's in the court system for 2-3 years, a lot of that childhood is gone. A lot of that childhood with their parents are gone. We can't replace that. That's why we need facilities, and we'll be working with you, Mike, but we need facilities now. You know, to wait to talk to Mike, which is a very beautiful man, that area has big problems too, because the Francis House, I know people on the street that I work with every day that would rather die than go into the Francis House. And I'm not saying it's a bad, you know, we need it, but the thing is, Francis House is a wet shelter. Wet shelters have multiple problems. And that's one of the things I've been fighting, like drug abuse. You know, you guys was listening to mental problems. You got Campus of Hope right by the Francis House. You got Open Door Mission. They got drug rehab. But the thing is, they're all, you can't help a drug addict or alcoholic by putting them in that neighborhood and keeping them in that neighborhood. People from Campus of Hope walk out with, oh, I'm free of alcohol. And then there's a guy out there handing him a bottle. Open Door Mission, same way. One of the programs that I have been working with very closely, believe it or not, is Fremont in Douglas County? Fremont has a shelter. And something that Douglas County needs to look at, they're very successful. They help pretty much everybody, because I take a lot of these women and children, because our shelters are completely full some days, and take them to Fremont. And so that's why I think we need a communication, us talking about all this. And I think the best man for the job is Mike starting this, because he, you know, he's been working with me how many years, Mike? About probably 20, 30 years?
Yep.
Long time. And that's what I need. You know, we need this Douglas County commissioners, because you control a lot of the help for Douglas County, you know, assistance. We need to improve that. They give $400 a month for people to get a home. Try to find a $400 apartment for these people. I have an example of this one Native American Mexican gentleman. I actually told this landlord he had two walls completely, no drywall, because he had a flood with a broken pipe. I actually got Habitat for Humanities to go in there, repair the walls, and this guy said, yes, we'll do $400 a month, no utilities. But that's rare. They give you a list of all these houses to pick from. I've called every one of them. Most of them, all of them are pretty well full. So we need a real discussion about the poverty problem in this city.
One of the areas, I was on the board for a long time, and now Commissioner Rogers is the Metro Area Continuum of Care for the Homeless. And I think that they are still working. They were looking to set up a housing pipeline, basically, to see what is available and how they could make other facilities more available for these very populations to which you speak. The kids who are aging out of the foster care system, we did work with Region 6 on that, and we have a voucher program for those individuals, and a lot of the referrals come through Project Everlast. So there are beginning to be pretty good and successful programs for that population, but I again think maybe if you had a conversation with Charles or Ann with Metro Area Continuum Care for the Homeless, that would be a good place for you to interject yourself with mm-hmm. the issue, because you have every provider in the community
involved in that one.
Not even just the shelters, but, you know,
everything.
Lots of resources around that table that may be of help, and the housing authorities are there as well.
And I have dealt with them before.
Okay.
Well, I just been to three meetings. This has been 3 months since I've been on. From what I know, if you're going to do it, you need to do it now, because they're in the middle of this 10-year strategic plan, and now they're having public hearings all over to get input and the community's view on it. So right now is your time to chime in on it.
You may want to even be a part of one of the committees that's there in that housing pipeline. Check to see if they're still doing that.
In fact, I know they are still
doing that.
Okay,
because that would be a good one. I mean, it's always been amazing to me that we do have facilities that are vacant in this community, in this county, that with rehab could be those facilities. But again, it's where you get the money and where you get the oversight of them and all of that. But that's one of the things that they were working on.
Mm-hmm.
So you may want to contact that group again and see.
And I will contact them. And the only thing I'm saying, though, is everything is the problem with the money.
Right.
And the thing about the money is, if you don't invest on the youth of today, mm-hmm. and it's proven day after day that if you don't, what happens? The youth turn on you.
Right.
In the 90s, the gangs turned on South Omaha for one reason only. We didn't understand the fluctuation of the Hispanics coming into South Omaha. All the Polish, the Czechs, the Germans, and all them moved out, and they moved in. So what happens? All these gringos that were left said, uh-oh, here comes the damn Mexicans. And me, Father Damien McCaslin, went in there, and we didn't change these people. What we did is we worked with these people, and now South Omaha is one of the most mellowless gang areas in the city.
Yeah.
And we used to get shootings and graffiti every day. And, you know, a lot of you that were on the board before, you helped me get this money. And that's something we need to invest money. And that's what I'm asking for. You know, and I'm going to work with Mike after this meeting. I'm a very busy man with the... because I'm overwhelmed sometimes.
I know, I saw that.
So what I'll do is I'll get a hold of you and have a sit-down talk with you, Mike. And I'd like to talk with you also, Rogers.
Yep.
Because you three have been, all of you have been involved. Dude, you've been around too. But the thing is, I only need three, and these are the three I picked. So I will get back to you guys' office, and we'll talk.
Absolutely. Thank you, and God bless you. Good to see you. Next, we will move to committees, the first one being the finance, and we have one of the chairs, Commissioner Duda. Anything besides the report?
The report is as presented. The budget hearings are on hold until Commissioner Morgan comes back into town, and then we'll have a whole bunch of budget hearings.
Next week, we start back up, yep. Next is the human resources, the weekly personnel report as presented. Any questions or comments on that? Next is the weekly CAO report on staff assaults. Patrick?
There were no assaults to report.
Sounds a little different, yes. And next is the legislative issues. We were successful on the overrides, which was a beautiful thing. We did hear that our aging, there was a about $1 million from the federal government that would come to the state of Nebraska to expand in-home services for the elderly, and we just found out yesterday that was vetoed. The part of that he didn't veto was that there was a task force that was to be set up to look at aging issues, study it, and whether in-home, nursing home, He kept that one intact. But there is already a motion that will be filed to override that veto, and I'm pretty sure at this point that it will be successful. But they are in a quandary down there right now by a lot of filibustering going on issues, so I don't know how fast or much that we'll get to by the time they're done. I think they're done Thursday, and then they wait the 5 days for the vetoes or anything else to happen, and then they come back and they're done. So all in all, it was actually a good legislative session for us on a lot of the issues, but we still have a ways to go before we're all the way done. Anybody want to talk about anything else with that? Commissioner Duda? Oh, sorry, Commissioner Rogers?
I don't know if I read it wrong. The email that was sent out last week about 464 and the change and LB 907, is that most likely, I'm assuming, because of all the debate on issues, is that thing going to move? Was it
that we're hoping that it moves.
Okay.
That again, I mean, it all kind of depends on the agenda and whether or not they can overcome some of the filibustering that's going on. But I know yesterday they spent a good, oh my gosh, was it 8 hours on 485?
Yeah.
I mean, it was forever. And then they went last night on, I don't even remember now.
I'm assuming the $5 million, and I watched this from afar, the $5 million was for the addition, I guess, for some of the due burdens that the counties were on. That was removed, but I guess we're still good to some extent.
Yes.
Okay.
But that was the debate, is that the money that they had for that, we wanted as counties the money to make us whole in terms of the transportation and the medical piece of it. And they're saying that money was there, that put in there in probation, if you will, and that the $5 million was going to be used for the community-based services. And so there was a lot of back and forth about that. And so then ultimately that money was taken out of the bill, and it remains out, is my understanding. But supposedly there's money that is supposed to be covering our county issues of medical and transportation. So I don't know when that'll come back up either for final, but
I might get lost.
Again, Commissioner Duda?
I just want to commend everybody that was involved with the overrides. The $10 million for mental health is still inadequate,
yep.
But it's a heck of a lot better than where we were without it. And I mean, I'm still almost incredulous after the state turns out people from their prison system that they say are ready to return to society that are clearly not ready to return to society, and yet they say, but mental health services are fine, we have no problems there. And wow, I'm so pleased that the efforts were made to restore at least some funding to mental health.
Well, and that's a good point, because here again, it's one of those where the reason that the $15 million was on the table to begin with, and the $5 million gone completely, and the $10 million kind of put in that rainy day fund, was because there was the hopes that we would see the savings from the Affordable Care Act implementation. Well, our argument all along was we didn't see those, nor do I believe we will, because I think if you look at the populations to which the region is responsible for paying for, well over 85% of those fall in the hole, the big gap in the Affordable Care Act implementation. Even if it was implemented, we would still have that gap. And so our argument is yes, we're very happy and supportive and thankful that we got the $10 million back, but you're still putting us at a $5 million deficit,
right?
Because we did not see the savings. Unfortunately, that argument didn't win, and we will probably have to do, well, not probably, we will be having to do budget adjustments because of not getting the $5 million. But you're right, it won't be as extreme as we had
been
told
worse
to begin with.
Yeah.
So anyway, we'll keep working on it, but that is, that to me is one of those things where the state, you know, it's well, if we see the savings. Well, we didn't see the savings, and yet it fell on deaf ears, I'll say. But we got the $10 million, so
yep.
Be thankful for that. Other than that, I don't believe there's anything else. We have a need for executive session for labor negotiations.
And litigation.
And litigation. Do we have a motion to go into executive session? Please vote.
Motion passes.
Ellen, I'm going to... Is there only two?
Only two.
Three?
B and C, yeah, only two.
It might help.
Motion passes.
America, America, God shed his grace on thee, and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea.